Today we are going to discuss about offensive GraphQL API exploitation. So who am I? I'm Arun, working as a senior security consultant at IBM India Software Labs. I've been a speaker at various security conferences and communities like COCON, B-Sides, Delhi, NULL, OWASP, Bangalore. And I'm a NULL Bangalore chapter lead. And I'm a member of OWASP Bangalore and B-Sides Bangalore as well. Today, we'll be discussing more on the GraphQL part and how an attacker can make use of GraphQL APIs to exfiltrate data from an infrastructure or the backend application. So GraphQL, basically this is a buzzword nowadays, right? So GraphQL, it is a open source project from Facebook. So GraphQL is a query language for API. It is actually, there's a misconception people usually think of when people start talking about GraphQL. Basically it is a query language, but it is not similar to your SQL because this query language is specifically for the API, not for the databases. So GraphQL server only exposes a single endpoint. So this is one important thing to note. So there are a couple of things we can discuss about GraphQL, but in this session, we'll concentrate more on the attack part of it. So how a bug bounty hunter or a penetration tester can make use of GraphQL technology while they are doing an assessment. So these are some of the pointers which is important for you to understand about the basic understanding of GraphQL. And if you wanted to learn more about GraphQL, I've given one hyperlink above in the slide. So slides will be shared later on. So on this link, you can learn a lot about GraphQL. And moving on, GraphQL schema. So GraphQL schema is something more important with respect to GraphQL, because GraphQL has its own type system that is used to define the schema of an API. So the syntax for writing a particular query is basically called as schema definition language, which is called as the SDL in short form. And basically the schema represents how an API is being crafted and how API will be interacting in the backend. The major components with that particular schema would be on queries, mutation and subscription. So these terms might be a little new for those who are new to GraphQL, but these are pretty much similar to our REST APIs we can think of, because queries, when we talk about queries, you can see here it is used for retrieving data or result. It is similar to our GET request in a REST API call. And moving on to the next one, mutation. So mutation is basically used for some state changing activities. For example, we have sometimes post request or a put or delete operation which has to be performed in a REST API or any sort of APIs in a web application. So every request which you see in GraphQL with respect to state change activities are referred to as mutations. And the next one would be on subscriptions. So subscriptions are pretty straightforward, because these are nothing but the real-time updates which we see in any APIs. For example, there might be stock exchanges and a few other places where we have to give our real-time updates. So these subscriptions will come into play there to give a real-time update. So you can pretty much compare these terminologies with REST APIs so that it will make sense. So let's see how architecture looks like for a GraphQL implementation. For example, I've given here one of the image which talks about the front end, back end, and the entire GraphQL structure. For example, consider that there is a client. The client can be from your mobile devices or laptops or any of the client side device. And that can be sometimes called as GraphIQL. We'll discuss about that later. Consider that some sort of GraphQL client is involved in the front end, and when a particular request has been sent from the client to the server, so there'll be a GraphQL endpoint. This GraphQL endpoint doesn't get changed. So as I explained in the first slide, for example, we have a couple of get, post, put or delete operations, wherein here it is called as query, mutation and subscription. So these operations remains the same in a single endpoint in GraphQL. And coming on to the backend part, here I've shown an example of a Lighthouse. So Lighthouse is a framework you can think of, basically used for a Laravel framework related applications. So in the backend part, you can see here now that the client have sent a request and the endpoint is a single endpoint. We have already discussed that it will be of queries and mutations and subscriptions. So subscription is not shown here. So queries, mutations and types, we will talk about these types later. So queries, it can be some get operations, mutation can be some state changing activities. So this particular request, when it reaches the backend, there is something called resolvers. So these resolvers plays a major role with respect to GraphQL. For example, let's say we take a query, which is like a GET request. In that particular GET request, you wanted to perform an operation, or in a mutation, we have a POST request, wherein that POST body value might require some data, right? For example, any name value pairs. So that name value pairs are called as fields here. So these fields might require some information from the backend database. So how that is going to get communicated in the backend is basically with the help of resolvers. So this is a simple architecture when it comes to a Laravel kind of a application which implements GraphQL APIs in it. When we talk about any particular technology, say in this case GraphQL, as we all know, if there is some new technology comes into play, there will be a lot of advantages and disadvantages to that. So even GraphQL is also one among that. There are certain cases where the REST APIs are designed in such a way that you might have to overfetch a particular data, or underfetch is also possible. We will discuss on that, how the overfetch and underfetch is being done, with an example in the upcoming slide. And it is pretty simple and efficient to use. When it comes to REST APIs, we have seen a lot of REST APIs which will be of different versions. For example, developer have come up with particular API they have developed for this particular quarter. The next quarter or in the next cycle, they might have to come up with a newer version of the same APIs. Maybe after fixing certain security bugs, and they have to put a new API. So what they tend to do with respect to REST APIs are, they might tend to create something called the endpoint with slash API v2, v3, v4. They usually increment that particular name, and then they'll be hosting that particular API in that endpoint. So what happens here is, maintaining that particular versioning is a tedious task with respect to REST APIs. But in terms of the GraphQL, it is pretty easy. So that's what the third point means. And schema introspection. So schema introspection is again one interesting topic. The SDL comes into play majorly here. So we can use introspection with that particular schema to pull out certain information which we require. So we can actually interact with that particular schema. Let's move on with the next one. So adapts to different requirements for different clients, like Facebook, Shopify, Pinterest, HackerOne. All these companies are using GraphQL technology. The main reason behind that is, like, it is pretty simple, and it has a lot of features and functionality which is far better than REST APIs. So let's take an example wherein you can see this is our client, a desktop or a mobile application, wherein from our browser we are just sending a GET request. With respect to REST APIs, you can see on the right side, it is something called slash users. For example, you wanted to pull out a user record. So there will be an API call called slash users and an ID value which represents a particular user. The same way, there will be different endpoints for different operations. Next endpoint, for example, slash users ID post, a post of a particular user. So you can do that with one more REST API call. So this goes on and on based on the requirement. But with respect to GraphQL, it is pretty straightforward, because what if we want to perform all these three operations in a single query? So that is pretty easy with respect to GraphQL, because REST APIs, the developer have to create three API calls. But with respect to GraphQL, this is just one simple query which will pull out the information for us. Three API tasks have been done within a single query. So what does this query means? So we'll discuss that in detail. So you can see here the user is being defined, and the ID value of the particular user. So here we are trying to pull out a particular user with respect to the ID as a reference, and name of the particular user, then post, and post again contains title. So I wanted to pull out the title of the particular post, and then followers, how many followers are there with respect to that particular post. These three API calls are converted into one GraphQL query, and the process has been done. So this is one typical case wherein GraphQL will be much helpful in nowadays, because there are cases where rather than invoking multiple API calls to perform a task, we can stick with one GraphQL call. And the next important thing with respect to GraphQL, in a pentester point of view, we have to discuss with the client to get some information about the API. So the clients tend to share some information about the APIs in different formats. It can be of your curl commands, or sometimes with Swagger documentation. The Swagger documentation looks similar to this. So, but most commonly referred API documentation would be of the Swagger documentation. So the Swagger documentation is pretty straightforward. It's just a URL, we load it, and then we can invoke all the API calls from the browser. Moving on with the GraphQL, the same client has to share some information to us so that we'll know what are the APIs that are there in that particular target. So to know that particular information, we have to have something similar to this Swagger documentation for GraphQL. So that is where the Graph IQL comes into play. So this Graph IQL is nothing but like a client-side ID development console. So how to access that? It might be in a particular endpoint called slash GraphQL slash Graph IQL, or the developer can rename it to any name they would like to give it. So based on that, we'll be able to access this particular console. So it just looks like that. We'll touch upon that later. We'll see in detail how to make use of this particular console. Moving on, as we already discussed, there are a lot of advantages to using GraphQL, but there are certain disadvantages or the weaknesses that are there with respect to GraphQL. So I'll call it as like weaknesses, not exactly major disadvantages, because these disadvantages can be omitted with certain configurations in the backend. So the main things would be like query complexity and depths. So how complex a query can be, that have to be controlled, or else there might be some consequences in the backend, and how much depth a particular query can be run into, because we have seen that in the REST API, there are multiple API calls we have to create for performing certain operation. But with respect to GraphQL, it is just a single query which is performing multiple operations, right? So it can be a complex query a particular user can craft in a larger application. In such cases, the query complexity plays a major role. So that is one important thing to note with respect to the weaknesses, because sometimes it tends to be a weakness rather than an advantage. So we'll see that in the demo part. And rate limiting and timeouts. So this is also one common issue which is there across all type of APIs. But with respect to GraphQL, again, that is a major concern there. And caching, again, this is a pretty important thing which a lot of people are facing nowadays. Then moving on, mainly we'll touch upon the opportunities which we have as a hacker or a pen tester or a bug bounty hunter. What is the main opportunity which is put in front of us using GraphQL? So we know that a lot of clients have started adopting the GraphQL architecture, and they started implementing all their API calls and migrating that from REST API to GraphQL. GraphQL server can interact with REST API server again in the backend as a API gateway, and then they can perform some REST activities as well. So that is also one type of model or the architecture they tend to follow. Since GraphQL is a new technology which is not much explored by a lot of pen testers or bug bounty hunters, so there are wide scope on it, and a lot of companies, since they are moving slowly to GraphQL, there are a lot of opportunity for a bug bounty hunter or a pen tester to find more bugs in it. Because when there is a new technology, we will be obviously sure, right, like from a pen tester point of view, that there might be a lot of misconfiguration in place, which will be done by a developer or a configuration side, something can go wrong. So there's the same case with respect to GraphQL. So GraphQL endpoints, the major ones to look for is the /GraphQL or /GraphIQL. Since I've already told that like these are some widely used ones nowadays. So for example, we have google.com /GraphQL. Consider that google.com is our particular target client, and we append /GraphQL as an endpoint or GraphIQL, we might be able to access that particular development console which we have seen in the previous slides. So this is publicly accessible, and I've noticed that a lot of people started reporting this particular thing as a vulnerability, because the development console, we can run an introspection query to see all the queries, mutation and subscription. That is nothing but the API information. So that is being reported as a sensitive information disclosure, but bug bounty programs, they tend to mark that as not to be reported, or sometimes it is not a serious issue. But there are cases where if it is misconfigured, that can lead to a particular impact. We will see upon that. So the main thing with respect to the GraphQL pen testing, for example, you got a target to perform a pen test or a bug bounty activity. So in that case, we have to start with the recon process, right? So recon is everything. So recon, the first thing we have to look upon is the introspection. So introspection, nothing but a piece of query we can craft, and that particular query will perform an operation to pull out a certain data from the backend schema. We are going to just interact with the schema, the SDL language structure, so to pull out certain information from the backend server. So that's what we are going to achieve with the introspection. So there are three cases to it. The one common thing to check when the introspection is allowed in a particular application is endpoint fuzzing. So this endpoint fuzzing is pretty common with respect to GraphQL or REST APIs, because in REST APIs, we tend to do a lot of fuzzing activities with the help of checklist or fuzzDB. The same approach remains for your GraphQL as well. So we just have to check for the endpoints GraphQL, /GraphQL or GraphIQL. So, but it is not the case that only it will be named as /GraphQL or GraphIQL. There are cases where the developer, depending on the configuration, they can rename that to a different name if they want, or if they want to put it in a different directory structure, the endpoint, they can do that. For example, /API or /a particular directory, then they can put GraphQL, or it can be renamed to some other name as well. So we have to do a trial and error there to fuzz that particular endpoint. So once that particular GraphQL interface is allowed, then we can run the introspection query to pull out all the queries, mutation and subscription. We'll see how to do that in the demo section. Then the next important thing would be the debug option. So this is quite common in GraphQL enabled web applications. For example, there's a web application wherein you notice that there's a GraphQL endpoint. There will be a lot of sensitive information which get disclosed there. So that will be an entry point there. And the queries mutation via schema. So as we discussed, like, we can run the introspection query and we can pull out all the queries, mutation and subscription, which are nothing but the APIs which are there in the target server. And these are common cases which I've noticed when we interact with an application which have introspection allowed. Let's take a different scenario here. Recent days, I've noticed that some of the developers usually tend to block that particular endpoint, the common endpoints like slash GraphQL or GraphQL, because that's the first point a pentester or a bug bounty hunter will look into, right, for an application. So what if they disable that particular endpoint and you are not able to run introspection in that particular endpoint? So in such cases, there are different approaches we have to follow. We can still run introspections even though that particular the endpoint GraphQL or GraphQL is not enabled, even if it is disabled and giving you a 403. So we can crawl that web application similar to our typical web application pen testing approach. So we have to explore more and parse the particular JavaScript files to see if there is any the GraphQL calls have been made. And even sometimes we can, just by view page source, we will be able to see a lot of information with respect to GraphQL. And the next one would be, after parsing the JavaScript files, if you come across any of the queries, the next approach would be to craft that query. Earlier, the case was like we can run an introspection, we'll be able to pull out a particular information wherein we'll be able to see query, mutation and subscription, the list of APIs which are there as part of each category. But in this case, consider that the endpoint is not there, but we are able to pass the JavaScript. We know that there are certain queries called via the web application, and we were able to see that, then the approach would be to craft that particular thing from our verb suit. So we have to craft by our own. So let's see how to do that in a while. So let's move on to the next slide. The next important thing with respect to recon we have to look into is the authentication scheme. Why authentication specifically? There are a lot of things we have to look into on an API, but especially on GraphQL, we have to spend more time on the authentication part, because the authentication can be of JWT tokens, or there might be access control issues, or there might be cases where I've seen there is no authentication being put in place at all. So authentication side, even they are using JWT token, so they tend to forget implementing security measures for JWT token, which is quite common in GraphQL, even in REST APIs, but in GraphQL it's quite common. And access control is again pretty important one to note with respect to GraphQL, because there are a lot of attacks have been done in the past with respect to the misconfigurations on access control. So access control plays a major role with respect to GraphQL testing. So tools. So what are the tools we can make use of while we are doing a pen testing or a bug bounty hunting? So we have to play around with certain tools, right? So there are certain tools which will come in handy when we do an assessment. So obviously in that list, there are three things which I could think of now. So which is InQL. So InQL is one awesome project, I would say, because it is in a pretty decent stage now. So the version 2 is already been released, and I'll show a demo on that in this session. And we have something called GraphQL Voyager. And GraphQL Voyager is not exactly a tool, that is like a web application wherein you can post the introspection output. Let's quickly move on to a demo. I'm currently running a particular application in my system, and it is hosted in the port 3000, and there is an endpoint called slash GraphQL. So this endpoint represents the console which I was talking about. So this is the GraphQL console. So in this application, it is exposed in the slash GraphQL endpoint. So in certain cases, it might be with a different name, as I said, GraphQL it can be, or with a different name altogether. So the main purpose of using this particular console is to know the list of queries, mutations and subscriptions. So when a particular application exposes this particular console, so it will be pretty straightforward, because this is like a documentation, as I said, similar to a Swagger documentation for GraphQL. And you can see on the right side, the explore documentation option will show you the root types. So the root types here are the query, mutation. When we explore the queries, we can see multiple queries are there: me, all users, user, post, search, get, asset. You can think of these names as nothing but like a endpoint name. For example, there might be a REST API call wherein it is allowing us to invoke a particular user entry. For example, me is a particular API in a REST API call wherein we can pull out information of our profile. For example, the ID, username, first name, last name, and post of our user account. So that we can use it in a REST API call. So likewise, these are similar to your REST API calls. You can think here with respect to GraphQL, it will be in this format. So just looking at the list of queries, we'll now come to know that there are around 6 API calls. So these 6 API calls are nothing but queries. So it means that these are some sort of GET request. And moving on to the mutation. So mutation, again, they have multiple mutations here. So register is a particular endpoint. And so this register, these are the parameters which it requires. So we can think of with REST API, this to be like a post request. And the login request. So the login request obviously can be post request, then password reset, create post. So there are around 5 mutations are here. So this particular development console, since it's exposed, it's pretty easy for us to see these queries and mutations. There are cases where we won't be able to get these information, the queries and mutations. In such cases, for example, consider that this application, we have slash GraphQL endpoint, but you won't be able to see this particular console, for example. There are certain cases like that. So in such case, you might have to run introspection query to see what are the entire scheme structure is looking like. So for that purpose, we can try using the introspection query. Let's quickly see how an introspection query looks like. For example, so this is one good GitHub repository wherein we can get a lot of information about GraphQL injection. So they have a pretty decent documentation here, which talks about most of all the attack scenarios and how to use an introspection query and what are different ways of using introspection query. And if you wanted to use the introspection query or in your console, we can even do that. Let's copy this particular introspection query and try it out in our application. Now here, this introspection query will pull out all the information about that particular target. You can see on the right side, there is some big response have come up here. So you can think of this particular console like a repeater tab wherein we send some request and then we got a response here. So this is the response for this particular query. And let's take this particular response. There is one more tool which I have talked about called GraphQL Voyager. We can take this introspection output and we can paste it here in this particular web applications. Later on, you can visit this particular website to perform for any application. So just copy the introspection output here and then click on display. So before clicking on display, I'll just show you a few samples which are already there in the site. For example, let me click on the chain schema. You can see here Stravos, Elp, GitHub, Shopify. So these are some of the companies wherein they already have GraphQL, Elp, GitHub, and Shopify. Let's look at the Shopify storefront as an example. Just click on it and display. So we can see here there is some graphical representation have been put in place here. So if we take a closer look, so there is something called query root. So this is where the query originated from. And we have customer as an entry and order is one more. And there is a relation from the customer field from the order to the order request. So you can think of these two to be different queries or mutations. So then that have in turn representation of mail address. So there is a reference which is specific to the particular shipping address, the mailing address. So this mailing address is referred in this table. The same way we have different notations here. So the main purpose of viewing this particular graph is to understand the business logic of it. For example, now that we know the introspection query output given a big scheme structure of that particular target application, we have to understand how that application functions, what are the APIs are there, and what is the business logic behind this APIs, how it is interrelated. So that if you wanted to understand this particular or the application will be really helpful. So let's now try with our introspection query output. Right now, this is just a vulnerable application, so it is pretty straightforward and it's just small representation. But in a real world application like Shopify, you can see, right, that's a sample which we have seen earlier. So that had a very complex structure. So we have to spend much time in it to understand the business logic. And here in this vulnerable application, you can see there's a root query. And we know that we have already seen there are a couple of queries in it. These are nothing but some GET operations. So this is a reference to particular user record. This particular API have a user record information which requires these fields: ID, username, first name, last name, and post. Likewise, this post in turn again requires these parameters: ID, title, content. Then there's some value called public with boolean and author. And there is one important case here, wherein this author of a particular post again refers back to the user table, wherein we can again nest it. For example, we know the author, and that particular author's information again we have to pull it. And in that, if we want to pass a particular parameter field called post, we can do that. So it is like we can nest it, since it's there is a backtracing here. Let's see how we can make use of this. So right now we have the introspection output. We have seen how the business logic looks like, and now that we know these are the queries and there are certain mutations to it. So let's move on to the next tool. The same thing can be achieved with various tools. So one among that is the GraphQL parser, and then InQL. So GraphQL parser we'll touch upon, and then we'll move on to the InQL one. So GraphQL parser, let me open my Burpsuit. From the Burpsuit app store, we'll be able to add a particular add-on. So likewise, I've added the GraphQL parser and GraphQL Raider. So these two extensions are pretty useful, and GraphQL parser from the GitHub repo, you might have to add it manually. And InQL, again, we can get it from the B app store. So I just added these three extensions in Burpsuit. So once I added that, for example, let's say this is the particular request, the introspection we have run. For that, there is a post request which got created here. So let's highlight that and keep it aside. So let's send this to repeater. So this is the introspection output for us. Right now, I need to find how many queries and mutations are there. We have seen that introspection, when it is allowed, it is pretty straightforward. We were able to get the information from the web application itself, because the development console was there enabled here. So in the right side, it's pretty much straightforward documentation. So we'll be able to see all the queries and mutations. But with respect to cases where the application doesn't have the endpoint exposed and the introspection is not allowed, in such cases, we might have to stick with the GraphQL parser. So this GraphQL parser, you can see here, when the introspection query have been run, this GraphQL parser have just showed that particular query, how it looks like. There's two add-ons are added. One is the parser one, the other one is the GraphQL Raider one. So here we can see in a tab structure, wherein this is nothing but the query. If there is a variable which is required for that particular query, it can be found here, and injection points. So what can be the potential injection points in that particular query? So this will be really helpful for us when we do any assessment, because in this case, it's just an introspection query. But when we talk about any of the get request or post request, it will be much helpful. So let's see how to use the InQL now, since we have seen GraphQL parser. InQL scanner, it's pretty straightforward. All you have to do is just provide the URL of the particular GraphQL endpoint where the GraphQL has been enabled in that application. For example, there might be targets like shopify.com/graphql, maybe one endpoint. If you find any endpoint like /graphql, you can directly provide the URL here, and then just click on load. You'll see this tree structure kind of representation similar to our burp target section. So this sitemap clearly says how many mutations are there, how many queries are there. Here we can see there are around 6 queries are there and mutations are there. So each query and mutation, how that structure should look like and how to craft that. So this InQL will be really helpful for us to know the entire structure, the syntax to craft that particular query. For example, here, let's take me. I want to just list my profile. So in that case, this is the query. Let's take this query. Even we can send it to repeater directly. When we send that, we ideally will get some error and we have to just correct it up. Since we have already captured some requests from the application, let's try to alter this one. Okay, let's say I wanted to edit this one. Going back to InQL scanner. So this is the query which I wanted to edit or craft for this API. Okay, so when I just added that in the GraphQL section, so you can see here that InQL have popped in here already, and the query structure here, since I told that all the GraphQL requests will be of a single endpoint, it's just a post request which is there. And as part of the query parameter, the values go. So since it's a post request, you can see here, the query representation here is with queries, there will be some escaping characters, and whatever we have entered here, which was converted like this in this format, in a raw format. Let's see in InQL, it'll be pretty easy there. When we send this, there is no variable for this particular request. We are trying to pull out a user record. So this user record requires ID, username, first name, last name, post. So let's see what is the error says. Field post of type must have a selection of subfield. So redeeming post. So it means that the post requires certain parameters. So we have seen that the post have certain values which we can send as part of post, right? So let's see how it look in the Voyager. We can see here the post have certain parameters which we can pass the fields ID, title, content, public author, right? So that we can pass it. For example, let's say this is the query. For ease of access, I just already crafted it. Let's take that and then pass it on here. Let's copy that particular NQL query directly into the console. So here we have noticed that the query got succeeded. Here I just directly use the console for now, but let's see what made the difference there, what we were missing. Let's take this request. This was the request. We have that particular query now. This will be really helpful. So what we can do is, in a real-time application, when we capture, so we explore the application, we come to know one GraphQL query. So we can stick with that particular request, and then we can move on and edit the same request, and then we can craft multiple requests. For example, consider that I have explored the application and found one query here, and this query was for pulling out the user record. In this case, it pulled out the ID, username, first name, last name, and post information of a particular user. And let's say the same request I have in the repeater. Now let's try with some other request. For example, all user. So for all user, this is the query. Let's go back here. Let's edit the same thing. And here again, it says some error occurred. This is because there's a subfield which it is requiring. We are making use of NQL, and since the introspection is not enabled or not allowed, we have to craft it by our own. So that's what we are trying to achieve here. Based on the error response, we have to understand it, and then we have to try to craft it. So let's see the all user query. So I think all user query I already have here. So let's try that again in here. Okay. So earlier what we did is, from NQL, you have observed that query all user ID, username, first name, last name, and post. But with the Voyager, we came to know that as part of introspection output, there are certain values which is required for your post section. So that's what it is not provided by the NQL, because it's a dynamic value, right? So NQL scanner is not giving that particular value. So we have to just add it. So that's what we did it now. For example, for post, I just provided one more field called ID. So now all the post information have been pulled out for all the users. So now if we explore these users, there might be cases where when we pull out all the user records, we'll be able to know some admin users which are there in that particular target environment. So there are a lot of other test cases as well. Who are the recent users which got created? So you can see here, these are some of the user accounts which I've created recently, and that doesn't have any ID reference of a post. So likewise, we can craft it whenever the introspection query, you are able to run it, but you got the introspection query output, and you are able to understand the business logic of it. So then we can directly see that from the console. If, for example, the console is not allowed, so in such cases we can run the introspection query. So we can send that as a get request query parameter. Then based on that, whatever output we get, we can go ahead and craft our own request. So in that case, the NQL scanner will be coming to play and will help us a lot. So now we know how to craft a particular query with GraphQL. So this is pretty important with respect to GraphQL, because the majority of time a pentester or bug bounty hunter would spend in any API would be on crafting part. So the mutation, again, these are some of the post requests or some sort of staging activity requests. So there is some request called super secret private mutation. This seems to be interesting, right? So since it's a vulnerable application, is directly mentioned as super secret private mutation. But in a real-time application, when I was testing, I noticed that by mistake a developer have exposed a particular mutation which was not intended to be exposed publicly. So that particular company, what they did, they exposed the GraphQL endpoint. I just loaded that in the NQL scanner. I was able to see a particular mutation which seems to be something suspicious, similar to this one. It is allowing a particular user to perform a delete operation of the entire database records. So for cleanup process, they have kept one particular mutation which will perform the cleanup task in their staging environment, since they have given staging for the testing part. And the same thing by mistake is in the production as well. That particular mutation, all I had to do is just craft that particular mutation, send that particular query, and it will wipe out all the data. So it's that serious. So the end user can anyway access the APIs. So what if there are certain APIs which are admin specific APIs? In REST APIs, we know that there will be some private or public APIs which are client facing and which are internal APIs. So that they will be segregating and keeping it. But with respect to GraphQL, sometimes there are a lot of misconfigurations wherein they tend to expose this information. So let's see, in this case, it's called super secret mutation. So this requires std out and std as the fields, and this requires command. So since it's like a admin kind of a function, there might be a command injection we can think of. Let's see what we can do with this particular request. So we have this particular query. Let's send this to see what is the response. It says that the command failed, command not found. It means that whatever command has been passed, it failed. So in KILS, kind of one important thing to note is whenever you see any of the queries, there will be some placeholders called ASD. So that is nothing but the user input is required for those queries. So just keep an eye on that, because in this particular query, for example, I am crafting kind of a post request. So let's pass some commands like a system command ls. So you can see here whatever the current directory I'm working on, so that particular directory structure has been displayed over here. So it means that the system commands have been sent. This is the same scenario I've noticed in one of the real-time application. So since the developer have misconfigured it to expose that particular internal API, which was intended to be for troubleshooting, but by mistake it was exposed publicly. So, and that can lead to direct command execution. So this is one main misconfiguration which they tend to do with respect to mutations, especially on mutation I've seen, because get requests, the queries are pretty straightforward to pull out certain information, right? So mutation is one place where we have to look into that. So this is one way of using NQL. So there are a lot of other features as well with respect to NQL. Let's move on with one more feature of NQL. So NQL scanner is not only available as part of a burp extension, there is one more command line version of it. So NQL scanner, so you can just go through this particular GitHub repository. This company have did a awesome research, and this is like a eye opener for any pen tester or a bug bounty hunter. They made our job pretty easy since they have come up with this extension. So this can be run as a standalone as well. If you have a Jython package in your MacBook, or in MacBook you can right away install Jython with Brew. If you have again Ubuntu, they have apt-get install. So after installing the Jython, you will be able to call that particular NQL. So this opens up like a standalone jar package. I've already opened it here. So all I did is just run the single command called Jython-m NQL. So that opens up this jar package, wherein you can provide the same URL similar to your burp extension. So that will again give you mutation and queries. So again, we can go ahead and see the particular request structure, and then we can even see a raw request. So this will be helpful if you wanted to send that particular request as part of your burp suit. So let's move on with the next one. So we have seen three tools which will be useful for us, and there are certain vulnerable applications are there, so which will be really helpful. So in this demo, I've been using GQL Goat, which is from Kaveh Systems. So they have created the GQL Goat, and it's an awesome project. This is a very good vulnerable application to practice GraphQL pen testing. So there is one more good resource I could think of is DigiNinja Labs. So DigiNinja Lab, they have a pretty decent labs are there. So he did a great job there to explain different phases, how to understand GraphQL first. So even there is a CTF, you can try it out. We all know that Pentest Lab is one good resource wherein we can go and practice our Pentest skills. So they do have two lab scenarios which is created with respect to GraphQL. One is on the SQL injection and the other one is introspection. So let's see one more important feature of NQL. So the recent update in NQL scanner gives one more feature which is called as GraphIQL. So we noticed that the GraphIQL console might be sometimes enabled by the developer or sometimes disabled. So let's say in this case it is disabled, for example. You wanted to still work on that particular console. I have heard of just trying out stuffs in this console because it's pretty straightforward and little easy to craft. And there are a lot of auto completions, and it's similar to an IDE you can think of. So this will be really helpful. And since this is not available in certain cases, so the NQL scanner, what they did is they have created something called send to GraphIQL. So when I do that, what happens here is you can see here there is a custom port have been opened in my localhost, and my particular application request have been hosted as part of your NQL scanner. So the NQL scanner, what it did is the development console which might be exposed by a developer in an application. So that same lookalike version you will be getting locally hosted in your own machine. So this will be really helpful for us because there will be a lot of auto completions, and you can even prettify the particular query, and you can pretty much do whatever job you want. So you can see here, when I just send the same request from my repeater, the same can be used in this localhost, and this can be again captured in your burp suit, and you can initiate scan as well. So this is one good option which is recently added to InQL scanner, which is pretty helpful. When a new technology comes, we know that, like I already told, there are a lot of issues comes along with it, and especially with respect to the vulnerability side. So there are a lot of threats might occur in a particular GraphQL environment. For example, the target application which hosts a GraphQL API, there might be cases that there are a lot of vulnerabilities exist there. So again, our job is to pen test that. So one important thing developers miss out in the initial phases when a new technology comes into play is that when a new technology comes and gives you more power, comes more responsibility. So same thing applies for your vulnerabilities as well, because with respect to REST APIs, we see these vulnerabilities more often, right? This is not the complete list, just these are the common vulnerabilities which we notice in any REST API and web applications. So the same thing is applicable for your GraphQL as well. Even DOS attacks is one major case which happens in GraphQL quite often, and that can lead to a resource exhaustion. We will see that in a demo. So I've been talking much, so let's see one more demo quickly. Let's see what I have here. What I did is that there are a lot of queries already there in the vulnerable application, right? So I just kept it handy to show the demo. So let's see. So insufficient authorization check. This is one vulnerability which I've observed in the vulnerable application. We'll use the same request and we'll try to alter this particular request. So what I'm trying to do here is I'm just sending this particular request. So what this query does, read my post. So this name can be anything, because we're just instructing that particular scheme that, so I'm running a query here. So it can be even with my name, for example, Arun, query Arun, the same result comes back. So this name can be anything. Then this returns the current user. So this particular query I just crafted for that vulnerable application. Here we have the resultant for that particular query. So which clearly says that which are the posts which are public and which are the posts which are private. So there might be cases there, there might be private posts as well, right? So what we can do is, since these posts are having particular ID reference, think of like an IDOS scenario here. I have crafted one more query which will expose all the post values of a particular user. Let's look into this query. So query, it can be something. So we shouldn't be able to read this particular post one. So there might be multiple posts. So there might be case that we should not be able to view the first post. So let's try to send this and see what is the response we get. But before to that, let's try to see the other post. For example, post ID is 2, public content. So now I'm trying to pull out a particular post which is public and which is with ID references 2. So I can keep on incrementing this, and what can go wrong with an ID value? In our web application pen testing strategy, if we see any ID values, obviously the first thing to try out is the IDOR condition, right? So the same thing applies here. So what if we wanted to check the first record which is there in that particular server? So if we can send that first request, then we can see here, since it's a vulnerable application again, so it shows that this is a private post, go away. So this you can think of in a real-time case where you are trying to call out a particular resource which you are not allowed to access. So like an access control issue comes again there. So access control is pretty common issue with respect to your GraphQL. So make sure to check the access control related issues, which is pretty common there. But trust me, this is similar scenarios happened in your real-time applications as well. And the same way, we can go ahead and try a lot of DOS attacks. And the initial resource which I've shared, so that contains a lot of information with respect to what sort of attacks can be possible in a GraphQL. For example, we have seen introspection from this payload, all the things GitHub repo. For example, we can extract a particular information from the target schema. Then the same way we can run mutations, there is some NoSQL injection we can perform, or SQL injection we can perform. There are a lot of batching attacks. So this batching attack, which is common with respect to authentication, when we are testing for any authentication related flaws in GraphQL, this is a pretty important thing to note, because there are cases where in API, if the rate limiting has been put in place for any brute force attempts, so that can be bypassed. So let's see how it happens. For example, consider that this is my single query. Let's see if there is any query as such which says the password reset. Yeah, there is a mutation called password reset. So this requires user input type and argument in JSON format. So the user input field should be of ID, username, first name, last name, post, and that should be of string and reference values, and input should be of JSON format. So what I did here is I just to make this task simple, so I just crafted it. So here you can see brute mutation. I just named it as brute force. It can be any name again, and I'm just mentioning that as a password reset. And it should be of a JSON structure, so I just pass the name value pairs here. So for this particular user account, if you wanted to change a particular password, so you can set that particular new password field value, and then you have to provide a reset token. This is how the actual query looks like. So what if you wanted to try out a brute force attack, or like running an intruder to see how random is that particular reset token is? If you wanted to try that out, basically there might be cases where the rate limiting will hit you badly when the protections are put in place. But since it's a GraphQL thing, we can have nested queries. So this is one good option there. We can have complex queries as well. So that is what we are doing here. We are just crafting one more queries and trying to pull out a particular information. So for example, here what I'm doing is making use of that feature to perform a brute force attack. What if I just keep on incrementing this value, and I can keep changing this reset token? Since this is like around a 6 to 7 digit, if you want to brute force, what if this is just a 4 digit or 5 digit? We can even start brute forcing it just with the nested query structure. So this is one common case which can happen in your password reset, or the password reset tokens. Obviously there will be some random IDs nowadays, so you can think of the same scenario in a login request, for example. Because in one of the real-time cases, I've noticed in a login request as well, when you try out username and password, if you try more than 2-3 atoms, then obviously there will be an account lockout condition, or there might be some ID reference which is set to that. And if you want to try out like a brute force attack, you can still do that just by using nested queries. So that is one good feature. And 2FA can also be bypassed with the same scenario. And moving on, there is one good interesting attack I would like to show, that is the resource exhaustion. So resource exhaustion, or DOS attack we can think of, which is a major issue with respect to GraphQL. The reason is, for example, consider that there is an application which is hosted in a cloud environment, and you have AWS, for example. So we have to use the GraphQL. For example, the GraphQL server has been put in place, and there are a lot of APIs exposed, and you are using these API calls. And what if there are multiple queries have been crafted in a nested way? The nested queries with complex queries can be crafted in a multiple depth. If we craft such queries, backend system, what happens is that it has to process a lot to provide you the response. In this vulnerable application, based on the GraphQL Voyager, we know that there is one query which can go in a loop. So in that user condition, so that there's something called post, which have subfields called ID, title, content, public, author, and this particular user will again traverse back to this particular user API call. So this again can call ID, user, first name, last name, and post information. This post can again have this ID value. So this can keep on going on. So there might be cases like this which can be a kind of a business logic flaw, or there might be by design. So we just have to identify that, and we can try out certain nested queries. So let's say in our case, we'll take this particular post calling request. So let's see how the request looks like. Since I'm going to do a recursive kind of a query, let me open that console and show that part. Okay. So I just missed the queue. It's a typo. So query recurs, it can be again any name. So all users, I'm just pulling out all the user records. So this is one among the API which is there already there in the query. So all users requires ID, username, first name, last name, and post. So I'm just pulling out for all users post, ID, title, content. I just need these fields is what I'm trying to pull out. So it listed this response. For all the user, it pulled out all the post of all users with ID, title, and content. You can see how big is the response here. So this is a big response, right? Obviously in the backend there might be some time took by the backend server to process this particular query, and we have got the response. Let's see, since I'm running it locally to show the resource exhaustion, let me show you how it happened in the backend. You can see here I'm just running that application locally, And you can see here how many requests have been sent, the select queries to pull out that user record, the post information from the table. So let me send it once again so that we can see that live. Again, there are multiple requests which is sent in the backend. So this is like a complex task, right? So this can go on and on. So what we can do here is let's start nesting it. So now that we have just tried to pull out a proper record, let me try pulling out some other values. For example, all users, I wanted to pull out post, and that particular post can have author information, and then author can again traverse back to the post, and the post can have again author. So this can go on and on. And for these values, the main important thing which is required is the ID value, because there are three things we can pull out from a post, correct? So the end node is the post. So we can pull out ID, title, content. So what happens here is, first of all, this particular all users ID, title and content can be retrieved. For example, let me add only ID and title for now. Let me send that. So it's taking some time to process it. So it means that what it is doing is it is trying to pull out the ID and title of this particular post for that particular first query. And again, since we have nested it, it will go through all these iterations. So for all users, post, again for author, again post, author, like that, it will keep on going. And you can see how big is the response now. So it's similar, same record which we are trying to pull out and trying to overload the backend system. So this we can craft it, wherein it we can cause a resource exhaustion. So let's see what we can do. We know that ID title is a small character length, right? So we can try to pull out the content. So content is again a little bigger value. So let's send that and see how big is the content responses. So now you can see that it is taking some time. Let's observe it here. So it's trying to pull out the values from the database and it is still processing. It's not yet done. Yeah, so now we can see that it pulled out the content. So this, what we can do is we can even nest it even further to cause a resource exhaustion. So let's try that resource exhaustion now. I think this would be the last demo because I'll be exhausting the resource in the backend, so the application might go into a crash state. And think of this like in a real-time case wherein the backend server can get crashed. We consider that it in the cloud environment, so that can cost you a lot. So this is like a serious issue which can happen in your GraphQL APIs. So let's try using this in the console itself. You can pretty much use the same thing in your burp suite as well. So let me send it here. So the same thing I did, nothing different here. So I just added few more post and author references in an nested structure and trying to pull out ID, title and content. Now let's send this particular value and it started processing. So what happens if I continuously click on sending it? So it means that I'm just firing up around 10 to 15 requests, for example, which had to process this number of records and everything based on your backend system load, how much load it can process. It can take a while to process these data. And what if we are just trying to overload it with a number of times? Since I've stopped at least to till this level, so and I sent it for like 10, 15 times. What if I can increase this to 100? And then run it. So obviously it will go to resource exhaustion. Even in this case, since it's around more than 10 iterations, I just sent it around 10 times. It means that more than 100 iterations you can think of. So it's still in process, progressing mode. So right now that resource has been totally utilized. So let's see what can go wrong in the backend. In any time now, it should go to a crash state. So we'll wait for that. So now you can see that I just ran it for some time and the syntax error, JSON parse unexpected character at line 1, column 1 of JSON data. So some syntax error occurred. What happens in the backend? So you can see here, there's a clear JS stack trace have come into play. It means that the resource exhaustion already happened here. So the application literally crashed and it couldn't process that much data to retrieve from the server. So you can see here the JavaScript heap out of memory. So since the application is locally run, it is the case, and think of in the server as well. So we can do certain nested queries like the recursive queries to perform the same operation. So this can cause a serious issue in a production environment because it can even bring down the service. And later any of the client won't be able to access that particular API resource. So that's a serious issue. Let's move on to our slides. Okay, we have seen a couple of examples which are pretty straightforward and seems to be pretty easy because since it's a vulnerable application. But what is the case in the real world? So there are a few examples I have given here because these are some of the new attacks which happened recently, or even say 1 month's time. I have noticed a few of the bugs have been reported recently, like 1 or 2 months back. For example, here this one is on July 16, 2020. So there are a lot of write-ups are there with respect to GraphQL in HackerOne. So one of the highest paid bounty from HackerOne is $20,000. So there are a few cases like this which happened in Shopify, HackerOne, Twitter, and a few other companies as well. So there are a lot of companies adopting GraphQL. So it's one good place to spend more time on in terms of bug bounty. And with respect to developer side, so I got you covered. Fix recommendation should be there in place at least to a certain extent because there is nothing foolproof mechanism which is there for any of the technology because there are certain fixes are there and they have to go back and fix it so that that bug doesn't exist again. So likewise for GraphQL, what I could think of is like the better one would be to disable the endpoint slash GraphQL, GraphIQL endpoints from the domain, and again crafting our own schema and avoiding the auto-generated schema definitions. So which will clearly say, okay, this is the query and mutation. So that can be avoided because if people go by the design of a particular tool, they tend to create the similar SQL structure, the schema structure. So they have to just come up with a new schema of their own. So that will be a little complex for a pen tester. And again, input validation, authentication, and authorization should never be forgotten. So that's like a thumb rule. So, and never trust a user input. So this is again applicable for GraphQL as well. And the one important thing with respect to resource exhaustion is enforcing a limit on maximum query depth. So this is pretty important because the maximum query depth and query complexity, timeouts, so these things has to be handled in proper way so that a DOS-related attacks doesn't happen in our environment. These are some of the fixed recommendations I can think of in a real-time case. So these are some of the resources which I've explored on. So these are some of the vulnerable applications and things I've practiced with, and there are certain good tools like GraphQL Parser and NQL. And the slides I've used some template, so credit goes to these people. So HiSlide.io and the demo app I've used from Kaveh Systems, the GraphQL Goat. So that's it from my side, guys. Thank you so much for watching.